أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبا القاسم محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء أما بعد respected scholars Elders, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Inshallah, the topic for tonight will revolve around a moral perspective, an ethical perspective, a perspective that is entitled to right between a father and a son figure. And inshallah, I would like to decipher this particular topic in three particular stages in the short time that we have for tonight. The first stage, inshallah, is we'd like to look at the effect of what Imam Zain al-Abidin says in the Treatise of Rights, Risalat al-Huquq, right number 23, about the rights of the father and what is implied, inshallah, to everyday life. Then we go on, after analyzing this, to who in history did not know who their fathers were, and the effects that this had on the community, the effects that's had in the social circles, the social norms. And after we analyze who did not know who their fathers were and their effects, we'd like to analyze the effect of people that knew who their fathers were and how they learned from them and achieved greatness within the community. And inshallah, that will end the topic for tonight. But before it, please help me in starting by reciting aloud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Imam Zain al-Abidin in the 23rd right in his book Risalat al-Huquq narrates that the right of the father is that you know that he is the root and you are but a branch, and if it was not for him you would cease to exist. أعلم أن حق الأب أنه الأصل وأنك الفرع. Therefore, he says, you know that your father is the root and you are but a branch. And if it was not for him, you would cease to exist. Then he goes on to say, and this is the beauty of the narration by Imam Zain al-Abidin. He says, know that anything that you find within yourself that pleases you, that you think this is admirable quality. He says, know the very root of that blessing is from your father. So anything that you find within yourself that you think, I have this particular trait that I like about myself, I am smart in this particular aspect, I have this particular characteristic. Imam Zain al-Abidin, what does he say? He says, know that the root of that blessing, that characteristic, that which pleases you within yourself, the root of the blessing is your father. Now let's see, look at the figures in history. Let's see what effect people that did not know who their fathers were had on history in reference to the people that knew who their fathers were. Now let's start by reciting the smallest surah in the Quran, which refers to one of these people. Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar wa salli li rabbika wanhar inna shani'aka huwal abtar. What does it say in the last ayah in this particular surah? It says, your opposition is the one that shall not have a lineage. Now this, if we look at the narrations, if we look at the translation of the Quran, we find that this person is attributed to al-As. Al-As, as we know in history, we find a person by the name of Amr ibn al-As, isn't it? We always refer to him as Amr ibn al-As. Where we look at the history books, we find, what did Ali ibn Abi Talib refer to this person as? Did Ali ibn Abi Talib call him Amr ibn al-As? Ali ibn Abi Talib, if you find in the Battle of Siffin, never called him Amr ibn al-As. He used to refer to him by his mother's name. He used to call him Amr ibn Nabagha, which he referred to his mother's name, because what? Because we know throughout history that As wasn't his actual father. Where we find his mother was one of those that spent her time with more than one person. Therefore, eight names were drawn out of a hat in which Al-As came out, and they said this is well attributed to Amr ibn Al-As. That's how he got his name. However, let's look at let's say Amr ibn Nabagha, as Ayyam ibn Talib says, what effect did he have in history? When we find in Safin, when we came together and said, you know what, we'll choose the leader, he comes from one side and he plots against Ali ibn Abi Talib, plots against his representative, in which everyone comes towards the other army. Amr ibn Nabagha is known to be one of the most hypocritical and the most, strengthened people against the Ahlul-bait, the people that hated Ahlul-bait, the people that plotted against Ahlul-bait, hand in hand with Muawiyah, where we find he got what he deserves when Muawiyah said, you're the second in charge after me, and therefore he stayed on his grave. He put a sword on his neck and he said, if you don't give bay'ah to Yazid, I will kill you and bury you with me. That was in his wasiyah. Now, taking that into account, that's one person. Look at what he caused into the community and the society he lived in. Another group of people, let's say. When we know a person by the name of Al-Mukhtar, when he goes out and to take revenge on Imam Hussein's killers, he captures 10 people in particular. These 10 people were the horse riders that trampled on the body of Abu Abdullah. He finds these 10 horse riders and look at this implication. He asks each and every one of them who their fathers were, the 10 horse riders. Each and every one, who was your father? He asks them. None of them knew who their fathers were. Does that make us start to think what kind of effect these people may have? What kind of effect does haram relations relate to and the offsprings and what they can do towards the community in which they live in? Let's look at the reverse angle now. Now that we know that the effects of that which is haram, that which they had bad fathers, which they did not know who their fathers were. Let's look at the reverse angle. Let's look at the people that knew who their fathers were. Let's look at the Ahlul Bayt. Let's look at how highly they thought of their fathers and how much they learned from them. When Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib relates to his son Al-Hasan, he says, I wanted as your father to cultivate jihad and Nahj al-Balagha. What does it say? He says, I wanted to teach you because the youth, look how Imam Ali says, it says the youth, their hearts is uncultivated. Nothing on there. Whatever you put on there, it will grow. Whatever you put on there, it will flourish. Whatever you put on there, it will accept. He says, I wanted to teach you at a young age. I wanted to cultivate your heart at a young age with all that which you needed. Now let's look at how Imam Hassan alayhi salam came up. Let's look at the Ahlul Bayt, how they came up. How proud were they to say that this was my father? When Imam Zain al-Abidin in the court of Yazid, his famous speech, how does he start it? How does he start his sermon against everyone that thought that he was one of the Khawarij? He begins by saying, he says, "A'tina sittun wa faddilna bisab'." What does he say? He says, the six that we are gifted by Allah, and we are also given seven. He says, "A'tina al-'ilma wal-hilma was-samahata wal-fasahata was-shaja'ata wal-mahabbata fi qulubil مؤمنين وفضلنا بأن منا النبي المختار ومنا الصديق ومنا الطيار ومنا أسد الله وأسد رسوله ومنا سبطي هذه الأمة ومنا مهديها صلى على محمد وعلى محمد. We find what? That he starts his sermon, that magnanimous sermon, by saying that I am from this lineage, from my family are these people, this. And what you see in front of you is an offspring of this greatness. And then he begins his speech. When he starts by saying, Ana ibn Makkah wa Mina, until the end of it, when he refers to the death of his father, Abu Abdullah al-Hussein. But what does it state? That he mentions his lineage. When Ali al-Akbar goes onto the battlefield, what does he say? Ana Ali ibn al-Hussein ibn Ali. I am Ali, son of Hussein, son of Ali, lineage. And even in Arabia, when someone was to come to fight, when the first battle in Islam happened, Badr, three people came to three people, isn't it? And they had the clash, the first fight off. Three people that came forth wasn't the three people that we know nowadays, which was Hamza, Ali ibn Abi Talib, and one other. It was three other people. However, when they introduced themselves, they said, we are not of noble blood. You are not of a known family. He says, go back, we want someone to fight from a noble family, from someone that's high. Such arrogant people, even in that particular instance. However, you see, after that, that's when Ali ibn Abi Talib comes forth. That's when Hamza comes forth. Because they knew who they were. They knew what their lineages were, what their essence was. Now take that all into account. Let's look at the characteristics in the father and how it portrayed in the son. In Nahj al-Balagha, when you open the book, you begin to realize stories about Ali ibn Abi Talib. One of the stories narrates that there was a man in a marketplace walking and he saw an old lady carrying a satchel or a bag on her back. She was very old. That her back used to be bent from the heaviness of that which was she was carrying. So this person comes towards this lady. He says to her, "Oh, Amat Allah, let me help you. Oh, woman, let me help you." And she says, "No, I don't need any help." He says, "I've seen you in the marketplace. I know that you are in need of help. Let me help you." On the way, he helps her. And on the way, look at what she's saying to this man. He says, "Why is it that you carry this by yourself? Do you not have a man? Isn't there anyone that can help you in the house?" She says, "No." He says, "Why?" He says, "Ali ibn Abi Talib," and she begins to curse him. She says, "Ali ibn Abi Talib took my family, my husband and my sons, to war, to Safin, and they died in that war as shuhada. Now I have no one to look after me." And she keeps cursing Ali ibn Abi Talib during the duration of that particular trip towards her house. Inside, the man begins to tell the lady, "Let me help you. You have children. Let me help you make the bread." He says, "Not a problem. Help me make the bread." So she finds that this person is making the bread and he's playing with the children. At that moment, he leaves that house. A lady walks in and she runs towards the owner of that house, that lady. And she says to him, "You are so blessed." He says, "Why?" He says, "Do you not know who've just walked out of your house?" He says, "This man, he's such a helpful person. He saw me in the streets. He also thinks of Ali ibn Abi Talib the same way I do." He says, "He's such a helpful person. He came, he helped me, he baked the bread, he played with my children." He says, "That is Ali ibn Abi Talib. That person that walked out of your house, that was Ali ibn Abi Talib." The woman runs towards the court of Ali ibn Abi Talib, runs towards Ali ibn Abi Talib. She says, "Forgive me, Ali, if I have oppressed you. Forgive me, Ali, if I've said anything that may have hurt you." Look at the reply of our Imam. And this is what we have to learn from. Ali ibn Abi Talib replies to this lady. What does he say? He says, "Oh, Amat Allah, forgive me. Forgive me if I have oppressed you. Forgive me if I have caused you any heartache or pressure." That's Ali ibn Abi Talib. That's what we find. Then Imam Hussein, alayhi afdal salati wa salam, on the 10th of Muharram, we find him crying. Why? People say, "We know you, we know your stature, we know you're the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Why is it that you cry?" And the reply comes, Imam Hussein says, "I do not cry for myself. I cry for these people that will go towards the hellfire because of me. These people that's why my tears are being shed. It's not for myself. I know where I'm going. I know who I am." It says, "My tears are for these people on the wrong path. I'm trying my best to bring them towards the message. However, they do not come. Their punishment shall be only one punishment and no other." Imam Hussein says that on the 10th of Muharram. That's why we see the balance. This is the father. This is the son. This is the offspring. Then we have the idea that the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. That's the tree. Imam Zain Abid says, "He is the root and the offspring is but a branch." Whatever Imam Hussein saw in himself that pleased him, the root of that blessing was who? Ali ibn Abi Talib. And so much that we can relate to every single one of our imams, the root of the blessing, we can go back. His father and his father and his father. That's the people that are our guidance. These are the people that we learn off. When we look at Ali ibn Abi Talib, when we learn this from the stories that he does, we learn from the analogies that he gives us. When Ali ibn Abi Talib is found, that's one day outside Ali ibn Abi Talib's house, a beggar comes and he finds an old man in very simple clothes outside. He goes to him, he goes, "Oh man, do you have anything for me to eat?" He says, "I do not have anything." But he points towards a house. He goes, "Go towards that house." He will provide for you. So the man goes to that house, he knocks the door, and he says, do you have anything to offer me? He says, of course. He provides. That's the house that Imam Hussein alayhi salam was in. Imam Hussein, before he let the man go, he says, who told you to come towards this particular household? And the man points at that man outside. And Imam Hussein tells him, he says, that man is the owner of this house. That's Ali ibn Abi Talib. That's Ali ibn Abi Talib. When he takes Qambar towards the shops, he finds that he had 3 dirhams. He buys clothes for Qambar with 2. He leaves 1 for himself. Qambar says, why? You are my master. I am your servant. He says, you are of youth. You need these particular garments. I do not need. He says, "Inna Aliyun Shaykhun Kabir." And he looks at himself. And he says, you are more willing of this. You are more needing of this. Ali ibn Abi Talib, when George Jardagh writes a whole book in honor of Ali ibn Abi Talib, why? A Christian man. What drives this Christian man to write a whole book about Ali ibn Abi Talib? He says, one particular incident of Ali ibn Abi Talib made me write a whole book in honor of him. What was the incident? He says, he came back from the battle of a civil war, that he comes back to his Medina in Kufa, where he ruled from. The people of the time built him what we look at nowadays as a White House, a place to rule from, like the Khalifas before him. Ali ibn Abi Talib comes, he sees that what they've built for him. What does he say? George Jardagh narrates, he says, after I saw this particular incident, after I read this particular incident, I came and I was drawn towards Ali ibn Abi Talib. He's still a Christian man. He said, I was drawn towards Ali ibn Abi Talib. What happened? He says he comes in to Kufa, he sees it. He says, I will never enter this and I will never rule from this place. Ali ibn Abi Talib, we've spent money, we've spent our fortunes, we've spent our time. Why is it that you will not enter this? Ali ibn Abi Talib, what does he say? He says, look at the roof. He says, how do you expect me to rule or to live in a place in which its roof is more elevated than the roof of the poor people? He says, Ali ibn Abi Talib will never live in such a place. Justice carried on through his son. Justice, when Imam Hussein alayhi afdhalus salatu wasalam on the 10th of Muharram or prior to the 10th of Muharram knew very well what the army would do. However, what did Imam Hussein do? Everything he had from water. Not only did he feed the army that stopped him, he also fed the animals, the horses, the water that he had saved for himself. He never, didn't leave anything for himself. He gave towards these people. Where do we see this? Ali ibn Abi Talib in Safin, when it's cut off the water, Muawiyah didn't give water to anyone. Ali ibn Abi Talib, as soon as he regained that water, he said, make sure you give the supply towards Muawiyah. I cannot be an oppressive person. He said, this is war. He says, doesn't matter. The rules still apply. This is justice. They need water. We need water. Open the gap for them. Let them use it. He says, Muawiyah stopped it from us. He says, that's the difference between Muawiyah and me. When we look at the narrations that says, look at where Ali ibn Abi Talib is to reference to the other khalifas, we find that the second khalifa, someone cursed the second khalifa. He took him and he had him whipped. Ali ibn Abi Talib goes past the mosque and he hears his name being cursed in the adhan. As we know, 70 years after Ali ibn Abi Talib's death, Muawiyah was still instilling this, that Ali ibn Abi Talib was cursed on the pulpits. Ali ibn Abi Talib hears his name being cursed. Did Ali ibn Abi Talib as Khalifa do anything? He says, may Allah forgive them, for they do not know. A Sunni scholar, a very high Sunni scholar, narrates this. And what does he say? He says, look at the difference between a person chosen by the people and a person chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He himself says it. He says, this is the difference. And look at the progeny that they had. When we look at the house of Muawiyah, what did it produce? It produced Yazid. Yazid, which kills Imam Hussein, alayhi afdhal salati wa salam, doesn't shed a tear, plays with his lips. However, on the reverse angle, he had what? He had what we call a monkey. It died, it had a 3-night or 3-day martyrdom for this particular monkey. People used to come towards the particular castle and give their commemorations to Yazid. Why? Because his monkey died. He goes and kills Imam of his time. That's the analogy that we have. That's the history books that we have, brothers and sisters. That's where we see the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. When we hold on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we hold on to the rope of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. There's a difference between the other schools of thought and what they hold on to, brothers and sisters. That's why we have to understand that, inshallah, and I end on this, the right of the father, and I mentioned this in the start, and I end with this, is that you know that he is the root of your blessing, whatever you see in yourself. Remember that a person went to the Prophet of Islam and asked him, he says, I am not getting sustenance, I'm not getting rizq. And the Prophet says, do you do A, B, C, D? He says, no, I do all of the above. And then he asks him, do you walk in front of your father? He says, yes. He says, that's why. Make sure you walk in behind your father, in respect of your father. When your father enters his room, make sure you stand in honor of your father. Offer him your seat. Not even in that, when we look at the Prophet of Islam, he used to get up for Fatima al-Zahra, don't we know that? He used to get up for Fatima al-Zahra. Why do we not do the same? It's the opposite reaction. We have to get up in honor of our fathers, give them our seats, walk behind our fathers in honor of them. Our Imam say, make sure you do not act in a manner, whether you think people see you or do not see you, in a manner which may cause harm or inflict any damage to your father's reputation. And there's so many guidelines in which we have to learn of how to respect our fathers, how to look up to our fathers, the rights that our fathers have over us. Very, very detailed, inshallah, and we'll get to it in the following nights. But for tonight, inshallah, I end on this. I've taken much of your time, and inshallah, I want to just put one last point, inshallah. And it's a very interesting point that we take for granted, is the idea of karma. Because in many, many stories that we know, whatever you do to your father, do not be surprised if your son or your daughter do the same to you. I'll end with one story in particular, in which a person took his father, a very old man, couldn't take care of himself. He used to clothe him. He used to bathe him. He used to take care of everything. He had enough at one stage, and he took him, he carried him on his back, took him towards the desert in under a tree. He put him down under the tree. So that's where he thought to himself, that's where I'll leave my father to die. You know, there's nothing left. And then as he's about to leave his father, the father begins to smile. The son looks back at him and he says, Father, why do you smile? And he says, you won't believe me if I told you. He says, what is it? He says, would you believe it that I did the exact same thing you are doing to my father? I'm not surprised that you're doing it to me. The person, as soon as he heard that, he picks up his father and he carries him home. The father says, what are you doing? He says, I do not want my son to do that which I did to you. So I want to be, and I want to be the best person I can to you, so my son can be the best person to me. That's why the idea is there, that do not act in a manner in which you do not want your son to act towards you. The idea of the overwhelming aspect of karma, let it be in the back of your mind, and however you act towards your parents. Because you will have to act in a manner which you want your children to act towards you. And I end, inshallah, on that note, brothers and sisters. And I pray to Allah that Allah may instill the relationships and strengthen it between a father and his son, between a mother and a daughter, and vice versa. Inshallah, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah can let us be firm on the wilaya of Ali ibn Abi Talib and grant us the blessing of being summoned as the soldiers of Imam Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman bi barakatil surat al-mubarakatil fatiha tasbiqaha salat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.